And so we are now moving on to the CS territory. So after a speaker from function analysis and a speaker in the optimization for machine learning community, we'll have Jan Kretinsky, who's a rising star in the formal systems community. So he received his PhD from the Czech Republic and done a postdoc in Vienna and now works at the Technical University of Munich. And hopefully he will return to the Czech Republic because he has recently received a multi-million euro grant. But he would tell you all about that if that works out.
Thank you very much. Welcome, everyone, and thanks for inviting me. And thanks for the opportunity to talk about a bit of work that I am interested in. And that is a bit, I would say, different from the previous talks. It's maybe more overlapping with the trustworthiness that is going to also be a topic of the session in the afternoon. But it's also about how math can help here. So I'm going to talk about an interesting intersection of AI and verification and how they can help each other, and sketch a few challenges as well as some examples showing directions how we could possibly overcome them. If you don't mind, I will try to actually have it very non-technical and high level. And if you have any questions also throughout the talk, don't hesitate to interrupt me. So let me start with something that we are all very much aware of, and that is obviously AI having tons of applications. And let's say you already have cool learning algorithms, you have all the math to make the tools work well, you have all the tools that learn for all these great applications, and you're very happy about them. So in some sense, this could seem to be the end of the story, but actually it's just the beginning of the next story, which is whenever you apply AI in any of these areas, and it doesn't really have to be processing of medical data or controlling medical devices, it's pretty clear that humans could be endangered, and of course not only just the traditional human safety in the physical sense of cyber-physical devices, but of course AI is applied in financial and legal matters and so on. So certainly you want to ensure that AI works well. What does that mean? Well, it doesn't really necessarily mean just that you approximate some function reasonably well. First of all, it of course means that there is some correctness of the function that you have learned. So that may mean not that you're close, but that in on certain types of inputs, you actually make no error, right? So it's just not that you're probably quite close, but you're simply not hitting the car in front of you, or that you're simply are fair with respect to some well-defined criteria when you are judging whether someone will get the loan. But this is still not the end of the story. Suppose that you even prove, say that we even, it's not even clear what the correctness actually means, so we will get to that later on. But say that you even prove mathematically clearly that the function is approximated well. Still, this is not the end of the story. You have to convince others that you have done so. And you will not do that using the proof. You will have to first obtain certification from the authorities. So you will actually have to convince people who are saying that this has been developed in accordance to the techniques that are considered okay. So you need to get an official stamp on it, and a proof is a helpful weapon, but this is not the end of the story. So you have to convince these certifying authorities, and this is still not the end of the story. You also have to convince the users and the people around you who are going to be affected by the decisions made by AI that actually the function that you are returning is the right one. So in particular, you need to make people believe that your system is indeed correct and is doing the right thing. All right, so for that, verification comes to the call to arms. Verification is the traditional task of verification is proving that systems are doing what they should be doing. So it should feel home well with correctness. No one feels at home with explainability yet. So let me show that verification can possibly help here. Now, the task is very hard, very new, and we need help with that. Fortunately, there is someone who can help us in verifying AI, and that is, who could that be? Well, as soon as we realize that verification is just another possible application of AI, we may try to call AI to help us verify AI. So with a pinch of salt, neural networks could be verifying other neural networks. Of course, the fun part is how to ensure trust in a neural network using another neural network that you don't trust either. All right, so let me see whether we can do anything about this. So what is verification? So many of you have not probably heard the word, or not, and at least not very frequently. It's a technique that has been applied very successfully in hardware systems in recent decades, also in software systems, cyber-physical systems. Essentially, the deal is you get the system, you get a property, and verification is here to tell you whether the property is satisfied or not, possibly giving you some additional information about, for instance, how to ensure the property, or if the property doesn't hold, what is the problem, where is for instance, the bug trace. Now, let me give you an example of something that, that we all know from textbooks, say from operating systems domain. You want to have a mutual exclusion algorithm, this is quite a classic task, but it has been proven by experience to be pretty hard to achieve in various complex settings, distributed settings and so on. There have been so many solutions that were wrong. And then, of course, if humans' lives don't depend on it, then who cares? But sometimes they do, and then you want to check that that your solution is correct. And then one approach is to actually specify exactly what are the properties that you want to achieve. In this case, it could be that the two agents are not accessing maybe the shared resource at the same time, but at the same time you're not really they're not deadlocking. There is some progress. There is some fairness. And so on. So there is a well-defined system, there is a well-defined set of properties, and then it's about finding efficient algorithms that decide whether the properties are satisfied. Okay. Now we're getting into much more interesting setting where on the one hand we have a well-defined system, but on the other hand we don't really have a well-defined set of properties. We don't really even know what that means. Exactly, say a neural network is recognizing well all the objects in the camera view. What does that really mean? I mean, in the end, there is a well-defined objective, which is we don't want to hit the car, right? If we're using it on autonomous driving domain, or we don't want the patient to die because of malfunctioning device. But that's just Too far away from the technicalities of what the AI is actually performing. I mean, what kind of task the AI is actually performing. And for that reason, people have been looking at various proxies. For instance, there is this idea of neural networks should be robust. So what does that mean? If you perturb an input, then the result of the neural network should be the same. So we all know these adversarial examples when whatever kind of, I don't know, elephant is then you change three bits in a large picture and then it classifies as zebra, right? Which is obviously something that is very funny, can be also very dangerous. And it's also clear that this property cannot really hold. Well, obviously, for all the images that are exactly really on the boundary of the two classes, of course, at this point, the function is not the approximation is not robust no matter what you do, because the actual original function is not robust. So what does that even mean to have something that is doing the job, right? So we are in a situation where we're not really approximating a function and we would like to be close to it, but we're in a situation where we really don't know what our function is, and people might even have disputes about what the function is. And then, okay, what is the desirable property? You can also do things such as range analysis, which is basically the neural network is not giving me some funny outputs, something that is completely nonsense. But this is more of a sanity check. It's not really checking that it's returning the numbers it should. So again, these are very incomplete specifications. So even if you are able to check any of those, then this doesn't really say that much about how well you learned and whether you can really rely on this. So what we also need to seek for is mathematical phrasing, mathematical understanding of correctness. What does it even mean for functions to be well approximating other functions in the setting? And people who are not actually trained in formal thinking and mathematics, who are actually just setting up the standards, they will not help us. It's up to us. Okay, we are not experts either, right? I mean, no one is, but we have to do something about that, and we have to figure out the formal side of it. And this is not coming. This is not coming from the regulations. They don't know how to do that. And this is what, of course, all the car companies are also quite afraid of. Right? I have some collaborations, for instance, with Audi, and then they are promising that we will deliver this and we will deliver that autonomous driving in a couple of years. Well, I mean, these things are still in the way, and they're working hard on this, right? But cannot say much more, but you get your picture, right? Okay, and say we already have the property we want to check. Of course, we're getting into the trouble of checking that the properties hold. So you have a well-defined system. That's good. But the traditional verification is only able to help or to prove properties of systems that are well structured in the following sense. If you have, say, a program, then you have a lot of variables. They have their meaning in the head of the programmer. There are invariants of cycles that maybe no one really writes down explicitly, but it's there. Is there in the background, and then there is a way of maybe automated provers figuring out how to proceed and how to prove correctness of programs. There is a lot of structure. Here what we see is a large mass, right? I mean, it's just like neurons connected with weird numbers. Of course there is structure. If there was no structure, it wouldn't be solving our problem. But it's exactly because we don't understand the problem, then we call for machine learning to solve it for us. We get a solution, and of course the deal is we don't understand the solution. That's why it's actually so good, right? I mean, this is a trade-off. If we could solve the problem easily, we would do that using a program. We wouldn't have to learn it. And where is now the structure, right? So for instance, let me give you a more concrete example. So in verification, one of the key instruments is abstraction, which is actually a key instrument of human knowledge anyway, to throw away pieces of information that are not so relevant, to keep the problem sort of simple enough. Now, how do you do that in the standard verification? Well, you figure out that different states of the program may be essentially equivalent. Maybe they differ in the value of one certain variable that is not really so important for the correctness of your program. And then you can reason about the simplified program. And that's what how you can tame the curse of dimensionality, so-called in this area called state space explosion problem. But we don't really know anything about the neural networks. How can we figure out that two neurons are essentially doing doing the same thing by not examining the network but directly looking at it, right, without doing much of a computation? Well, I will get to some ideas later. All right, so we are in a setting where we don't really know exactly what our problem is. And if we have the problem defined, then we are in a setting where we have not too many ideas how to approach it using the standard techniques. And this is also the situation of people who are approaching it from, say, the machine learning area. They are looking at the robustness analysis of their neural networks and so on. But again, I mean, there are the two drawbacks. Robustness may not be the thing that you want to prove, and even if it is, then what they're doing is they're proving it with high probability or on areas that have at least some measure, maybe not in the one specific example that may still happen, and therefore this is not really certifiable because it's still possible that that things like that happen. All right. So this is one part of the story, the correctness. The other part of the story is, even if you have now a correct system, even a provably correct one, then you are supposed to, according to the standards that are already a couple of years old, both in European Union and US, you're supposed to make the system explainable. If you try to search for what that means, you learn very useful information such as it means understandable by human. Well, at least we know that by human. But by whom? We don't even know that, right? I mean, is that the domain expert who designed the solution? Is that the people who run the service? Is it even just the customer? Should the customer understand it? And there are, of course, legal battles about various interpretations of these regulations. I'm going to stay away from that. But what is interesting is it then supposed to be understandable using the domain knowledge? Often the people who are actually programming or learning a solution to some problem, they're not even domain experts, right? They don't even know, I mean, when they get a solution, they have no clue whether this is a correct one or not, because they actually don't even understand the problem, right? I mean, are these people supposed to understand it, or do I have to be a domain expert in order to understand it? This is also not very clear. And let me just give you a glimpse at what some people do in explainability. It, of course, usually depends now on what are you explaining. So on the one hand, we have something that is still quite manageable, which is concrete decisions of AI-based systems. Okay, so you have a neural network that says, no, you don't get the loan. Now, of course, you're interested in, like, okay, why? Okay, I'm earning enough, why? And then people say, okay, well, maybe we could give explanations in terms of counterfactuals, meaning what has to be different in order to receive the loan. Okay, so of course this is easy, right? Or easy in the sense of we know what to do. Now comes all the math that takes the function and sees, okay, what is the minimum change so that we actually get an answer in the other class. Okay, and this is then, I mean, if you want to get the least possible change, this is when the optimization comes into place and all the cool math can take place, because we already know what to do. On the other side of the spectrum, we're supposed to even explain the systems. What the hell means that? No one really knows. Of course, we have some understanding of the systems, maybe in terms of rules. So, I mean, the traditional rule-based systems, like programs, for instance, we have maybe some domain knowledge, so we know, okay, we probably, when we are right behind another car, we probably shouldn't accelerate because we would be hitting it. But that's not saying it all, right? And there's a lot, I mean, if we understood the system in terms of rules, we wouldn't have to call for learning. Now, we have learning there because there are a couple of things that we don't understand. We have to learn them. And then we need to now combine the sort of symbolic rule-based things with the learned systems. And, of course, neurosymbolic topics are fancy these days, so I mean there are some ideas how to proceed, but the whole area is still trying to find the vague directions and is very unclear. In the middle of it, there is maybe a story that I want to zoom in on in a minute or two, or for a minute or two, which is representation of controllers. So what do I mean by that? Maybe you have a cyber-physical system, could be a robot moving somewhere, and then it's supposed to make some decisions so that it behaves well, say in interaction with humans. And maybe what we could also do is not to forget about the rest of the AI. So it's all about neural networks these days because they can be trained well, as opposed to, say, for instance, decision trees, right? I mean, this is who would use decision trees these days when you can have a neural network which is much faster. I mean, it's faster trained, much more accurate. But, well, there are other advantages or there are other points than just approximating well, and that is decision trees, for instance, are more interpretable. And they have, I mean, this is something that people use when you get your car repaired. I mean, this is what the people in the repair facility are using. They understand it, right? I mean, is the engine turning on or not? If not, I mean, is then oil dripping from the engine or whatever? And if yes, okay, what should I do next, right? I mean, this is something that everyone understands. So let me give you a brief example of a controller. Right, this is a controller. Okay, so you probably don't really see it. It's megabytes of lines. If you zoom in a bit, this is a control that for each state of the system tells you which actions are safe. What is this? And this is many thousand lines of these, actually just describing what you can do in a flat with 10 rooms, two heaters, and then, I mean, sensor in each room. Now, what are you supposed to do when you can turn the heater on and this one off and so on? Very, very complex, right? What you would rather like to do is to actually distill the information, but not into another neural network or anything. But you would like to use some data structure that you understand. Okay, first try. If you know about them, binary decision diagrams, a big thing in many areas to represent complexly Boolean functions. Not really. Okay, maybe something else. Maybe you actually need to employ learning to figure out what is deep down there. It turns out that to obtain a safe controller, you can actually simply do the following. If the temperature in that room is low, then you turn the heater on, and the same for the other one, and that's basically it. And you obtain a safe controller. And of course, you don't even need the other sensors, and all that you learned is actually in the end quite trivial, right? I mean, this is an extreme case, but I mean, you save a lot, and maybe this is still an extreme case, as I said. But you really want to see what the controller is really doing. Maybe let me give you very briefly another example. A very simplified system for keeping distance between the cars. If you create a table, what to do in each state of the system. I mean, you can't really read it, you can't really analyze it, you can't verify it, it's just too large. Now we can create a decision tree. Now, is this understandable or not? Now, what is this? I mean, you have seen quite fancy formulae in the previous talks. But still, I mean, is this understandable or not? Well, it really depends. If you have the domain knowledge, like the kinematics equations, it's pretty easy to actually figure out that these turn out to be simply the worst case distance to hit the car. If I mean, if you're accelerating, then you take the worst case overall, what the other car can do, and this is then the critical distance, which then makes a lot of sense, right? It didn't make it here, right? So what we have to do is, of course, to merge the approach that learns maybe these interpretable data structures also with something that learns sense out of expressions, right? Which is also what people do, and so there are ways how to approach this problem. So let me then summarize. Let me just skip over that. That many of the approaches that are appearing in the field are of the form, okay, we don't know what to do, we call learning to our aid. Of course, learning is not reliable, so what we do is we observe the system for a while, maybe observe a couple of runs of a program, and then we figure out what the invariant of the program might be, and then we can check it, right? The guess can be wrong, that's okay. Then we go on searching, right? But you can use AI to actually then provably get the properties of your system. Or maybe you observe a neural network, you observe the behavior of some neurons, and you make a hypothesis, you make a guess that maybe actually they are doing something. And then once you have that guess, then it's way easier to prove it than if you don't even have the guess. So it also has, I mean, in this area, it is vital to bring also the methods, the wild methods, wild unreliable methods of machine learning and the classical math together to pull one rope in one direction. And let me then just conclude. Verification as well as math are to be here in a dialogue with AI and not one directional application or analysis. They should help each other, and we have seen on a couple of examples that such things are possible and happening over the past few years. So I wish us good luck in pursuing this. Thank you very much.
Question, maybe? Cordelia? I'll run with the mic.
Which of these different techniques will give us the most gain? I guess these decision trees, they're probably very nice for specific applications, but probably not generalizable to any kind of approaches. So anyway, what is your intuition? I mean, like, where are we going to be in 5 years? Do you have any intuition where this will be heading and what is most promising? I mean, if you would want to have one big bet, what would be your take on it?
Let me comment on exactly the what you mentioned, the decision trees and in 5 years. Well, firstly, in 5 years, I think we will move a bit, but we will still be looking around. It takes some time. It's already a couple of years, and actually I learned that very recently that Hinton suggested, Jeffrey Hinton, the guy who got the sort of Nobel Prize, right, for neural networks, the Turing Prize. He suggested we should be working with decision trees that in their nodes have neural networks, so that we understand the overall structure of decision, and then the subroutines that we don't understand should be actually dealt with the neural networks, because I mean that's where we need the learning. If we have something like we had, I mean it's already gone. I mean the funny formula, that's the thing. Maybe that's the thing that you don't understand. You need a neural network there, but then there is some magic thing that tells you what the distance should be. And then you understand, okay, I probably should not be too close. What that means is hard to compute, the neural network does it for me. But I understand it in the context of the whole decision making. So the key is, it's not going to be decision trees, but at the very least, it's going to be a combination of, say, decision trees and neural networks. We have already seen it. More complex predicates, but there have to be also other ones. So the thing is, we will have to combine this into new models. I mean, that model has been suggested a couple of years ago. No one is still learning it. No one probably knows how to do that well. But this is a model that could be much helpful. It's there for a couple of years suggested. People are still not learning it because they don't know how. And we need these types of models, of course, together with the adequate learning procedures and the math that tells us how to operate with them. And only then we can hope both for understandability and accurateness. So I would start with that one. It's there for already a couple of years. People agree this could be a good thing, and we still don't know how. So maybe we need to find the right subclass, the right tweaks. And I would start with that one. And if in 5 years we don't know for at least that single thing how to do that, I would be already very happy. I'd be also happy to take questions offline.
Maybe a last quick question. So is it possible to display the slides and just go back just after the just before the conclusion, please? You described a protocol for explainability and understanding of neural networks, and I was wondering if it is automatized. I don't understand where human is and where machine is.
Mm-hmm. All right, so of course this is a bit of a process. So what we are actually having is a tool that, for instance...
Before.
So for many of these things, we do have semi-automated to automated procedures already. Right. So, for instance, for seeking invariants based on runs of programs, this is something that people have been working on, or many people have been working on, for already, I would say, 6 years or so. So there are already quite some tools. For producing these trees, we already also have a tool that actually does quite a bit. But in order to be very powerful and figure out these more complex things, such as these predicates, there needs to be a bit of intervention of the human. For instance, we need that you enter the kinematics equations, and then we are blindly searching for these expressions. Of course, if we had better guidance, it would be better. So, I mean, it's semi-automatic, and there is, of course, vision to make it fully automated, but it will always depend on some inputs of the human, at least optionally, because whenever you know something, you should not let machine learning figure it out on its own. You should enter that information. Of course, this is also something that people still don't know well. I mean, how to merge rule-based systems and learning-based systems. If you have prior knowledge, how to efficiently encode it into your mechanism. This is something that needs some time, but I mean there are already some automated procedures that deliver results according to this scheme. Thanks for the questions. Thank